and go back to the prepsispinal. So are there any questions here that we should address first on the prepsispinal? Or should I just go through the question in sequence? Okay, so let's begin with question number one. Like the example that we had in class yesterday, comparing project A to project B. So this is really, oh, sorry about that. I'm about to get out of version. This question is an example of cost-benefit analysis. We first define a common basis of measurement for comparing the values of different projects. And the problem in this particular question is that the two projects differ in timing. And project A, we get the revenues faster than in project B. But on the other hand, the total revenues in current terms are greater for B than for A. So we need some way of adjusting for these differences in timing and also in current values. So ideally, we would use present value. So this is the value today, as you know, of a stream of revenues and costs that occur over time. So, for example, of the present value of 100 KGI to be received next year is the amount of money that we can put in the bank today and have 100 after the year passes. So, present value is a nice common denominator when comparing projects. because it adjusts for differences in timing. We just compared the amount of money that we would have to put in the bank today in order to have the equivalent of the streams of revenues in terms of value. Okay, and remember that the present value of $8 could be received after N years. Given an interest rate or discount rate. Of R is A divided by 1 plus the interest rate R taken to the power N. So once we understand the rationale behind cost benefit analysis, that the rest of this problem is just a matter of applying the present value formula. So let's look at the present value of project A. In this case, we spend $10 million immediately to build our project. And then next year, we receive $20 million of this profit at the rate of 25%. And that works up to $6 million. So in other words, if they took $6 million in the bank today, people have the same overall value as people did from project A. And the same thing for project B. But this present value involves paying for construction for 2 years rather than just 1 year. Minus $10 million immediately, and then next year, we spend another $10 million on construction. So since this occurs in the future, you have to discount at the rate of interest. And then suddenly, in the year after that, we received $40 million in revenues after 2 years. So that take the additional taxes to the public too into the denominator. So this present value of course up to $7.6 million. So since the present value is greater for D than for project A, the D developer should want D better than A. And that's all that there is to that particular problem, number one on the practice final. Any questions about that question? Okay, so let's go now to question number two concerning the interest rate or the yield on a simple bond. And I'll go back now to the whiteboard. So put some background to that question. A bond is not, it's just a loan. The seller of the bond is spending money to the borrower. So for example, if I sell to you a new bond with the face value of $1,000. And I am lending to you $1,000 in exchange for a payment of interest that is fixed over time. In this case, of $100 per year. And then in most bonds, after the bond fully matures, you will pay back the principal as well. of certain verbs. You have already paid off the interest. Of the fifth payment of interest that's in each year. It's called the coupon payment of because usually bonds historically had coupons attached to them that corresponded to the interest payment. And the payment never changes until the bond is paid off. Okay, now in this case, we are looking at a special bond called the council bond. It never matures. It yields coupon payment forever. So, for example, the British issued council bonds to pay for the Napoleonic War in the early 1800s. Those bonds are still around. Okay. So, for this kind of bond, the coupon payment is always equal to the price of the bond times the interest rate on the bond or the yield. For example, if the coupon payment is $100 per year and the face value of the bond is $1,000, then the interest rate revealed on the bond is 100 divided by $1,000. Or an interest rate of 10%. In general, the interest rate is equal to the coupon payment divided by the bond price. Now, although the coupon payment never changes, the bond price can change in the market. But Hook the circle. The bone in a person. That's an initial value. Of $3,000, but the bondholder can then sell that bond on the open market to somebody else. Say the idols. And then idols. Will pay for the bond, let's say $2,000. So since the bond first has changed, the interest rate on the bond also changes. Using a formula, that the interest rate is equal to the coupon payment divided by the current price of the bond. You get $100, never changes. That's a coupon payment. But not divided by the price of 2,000 rather than 1,000. So the interest rate has changed from 10% to 5%. So note that when the bond price rises, the yield falls. There is an inverse relationship between the bond price and the interest rate. For example, when the central bank buys bonds from other loans, it pushes up the price of the bond because there's an increased demand for the bond. Since the bond price rises, the interest rate falls. For most central banks in the West, and to some extent in Kazakhstan as well, this is how they will lower interest rates to try to encourage lending and spending. And of course, higher spending will raise the value of the economy, GDP. any questions about that person? Number two. Okay. Question number three is addressed in chapter 15, and it concerns how we can take this into account. So the best return on an asset that does not generate the risk of bankruptcy is 4%. And then the average rate of return in the economy is 6%. And then finally, the beta is 1 for firm A. So let's look at that problem more closely. In this example, the risk that you are considering is the probability of bankruptcy. So, for example, there is virtually no chance that the United States government will go bankrupt. At least that used to be the case. So the bonds that are sold, the government, are risk-free. Since they have a rate of return of 4%. If people could know that this fee rate of return is 4%. And there is the abbreviation for the risk-free rate of return. So we should certainly And then the minimum return to a risky enterprise that is an enterprise that needs a bankrupt of 4%. One way of avoiding risk is to diversify a portfolio. So for example, if the home of structures in oil companies, you should also add to the portfolio shares in companies that do well when oil companies do not do well. A shares in companies that conserve energy. Say, but something won't work. In general, we can eliminate this easily these kinds of risk just by diversifying. So we won't worry much about diversifiable risk. But we cannot eliminate all risk for diversifying. For example, the coronavirus has put many small firms in bankruptcy. Because of the lockdowns. But there is virtually no way that we can anticipate a pandemic years in advance. And so we have to accept this kind of risk of bankruptcy. People call this non-diversifiable risk. in exchange for accepting this risk, but lending money, for example, to restaurants, people demand a higher rate of return. But this is the best premium. So, for example, suppose that the risk-free rate of return is 4%, and that the average return on a risky project is 6%, then the risk premium is 6% minus 2% minus 4%, or 2%. People demand an increase in a rate of return expected. Of 2% before you don't invest in the restaurant. So the question now is, how can we estimate the average return to risky projects? One way is to take a look at the average return on all enterprises in the corresponding eternity. Since virtually all enterprises involve some risk. That is, we expect some probability of bankruptcy. So let's note that average return if or am. And then finally, the third element in addition to this theme returns with Orgas and Orion to this return. The third element is the extent to which the third element is the extent to which a particular project that maybe a Greek festival in Almaty is sensitive to this that characterizes all the perfect stars. But we will call this sensitivity data. The higher that this that data is, the more sensitive a particular project is to average risk. So, for example, the project that we are considering an airline that is done. If these are flying, it's very sensitive to the overall impact in the economy. Because these are travelers will delay traveling if they don't have money. So the data for Interstellar is probably greater than one. That is, the airline is unusually sensitive to this. So this put these three elements together. In a model called Pepin. That model for a typical acid person. Assumes that the firm will have to provide, will have to pay a risk premium, that is a proportional to excess risk in the economy in general. So this denotes the rate of return firm I, this or I, then in the Pepin formula, we have that the risk premium to that particular firm is proportional to beta, is proportional to the excess risk in the economy in general, or M minus RL. So now we have an easy way to calculate the required risk of rate of return to firm I. So suppose that beta is average because our firm is typical of the national neutrality. And the risk free return is still 4%. And the market rate of return is 6%. Then RI minus risk-free return of 4% is equal to 1 times the market return of 6% minus 4%. So RI is equal to 4%. Adding 4% to both sides. So 1 times 2% or 6%. That is the minimum made a return. The people of the man of firm eyes. The poor people invest in it. And Chesterton is not surprising. Because this term was typical of Chesterton's economy. Or on the other hand, if you're looking at Aristotle, people probably demand a higher rate of return. And because Aristotle is sensitive to undiversifiable risk. Questions about that problem. The remainder of the practice final consists of a question that we have already addressed in class. So I will go through this quickly unless you have questions. So in question four, the habit demand function, inverse demand function. A price equals the quantity minus output Q for the monopolist. And we also have zero marginal cost. So, as you know, the monopolist will decide how much to produce. The infringing marginal revenue to marginal cost. In this problem, marginal revenue is 20 minus 2Q. So since marginal cost is zero, we can solve easily to Q. This is 10 in this case. And then for the price, we will use the demand function for the highest price that people are willing to pay for 10 units. And that's T equals to 20 minus Q or 10. Or a price of $10 in this case. So I think that you're already familiar with that problem. Question 5 is a straightforward game problem. With a definition for mass equilibrium. So the only thing that I will note here is that mass equilibrium occurs when given what other agents do, our agent will offer the best response. A given TDGU serves as high tradition. So will peanut. And given the peanut serves as high tradition, so will 2BTU. So here are the options between it. Head to listen or go to listen. And at least in this game, the 10 options to you. So, for example, if we assume that teaching to you, so it's hard to listen to them, they'll do better with hard to listen rather than low, to do better than zero. And the same kind of reasoning holds if teaching to you versus first low to listen, three is better than one to team up. Since the game is symmetrical, teaching to do also will do this, but teaching hard to listen regardless of what team that does. So, high tuition for both universities is a nasty proverbial. Also, a dominant strategy. And then the last question is very simple. It's really just a matter of economic reasoning. So the typical buyer has an interest in their function. A printing one is huge. And there is no marginal cost in the problem. And you recall that in the two-part tariff, the monopolist will charge a membership fee consisting of consumer returns in this case, or consumer surplus. And also a unit fee for every unit of output that the buyer is buying. So let's take a look at the demand function in this case. And there is, oh, sorry about that. There is a demand function right there. The intercepts are easy to calculate. And so now the monopoly will charge the entire triangular area, since that area is considered surplus. So the membership G by the Pythagorean theorem is 1/2 times pi times of 8. Of 20 times 20, 200 in all. And then the unit C is 0. It's because we have already taken all of the consumer's surplus. There's nothing left over that the consumer is willing to pay. She is not willing to pay the user fee. And if you charge one, she will not buy at all. And I think that takes care of the problems on the practice final, unless you have questions.